Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Hey, guys. Bless you all. So, kids, last week, we forgot to bless you guys and pray for you guys, and I'm so sorry. So, I want to do it first thing this time. I want to bless you guys. Come on up, you kids. Come on. Come on. Come on up. Because I am believing the Lord to encounter you guys today during worship. I am believing the Lord to touch you guys, okay? So who can tell me, just raise your hand, who can tell me what Jesus said about little children? What is it?
Come, children.
That's right. He did say come. That's right. Did you guys know that Jesus actually said to be the greatest in the kingdom, you have to be like a child? Did you guys know that? So I know I'm an adult, but I'm supposed to actually learn from you guys. You guys are kind of like our teachers, because Jesus said, and you know when Jesus says something, you got to listen up. Jesus said, we got to be like more like you guys. So you guys are our teachers today, okay? You guys are going to teach us what it looks like to worship, okay? So teachers, raise your hand and tell me what is a good example of what you're supposed to do in worship.
I forgot.
Okay.
Sing the songs.
Sing the songs, okay.
Don't get up and be the distraction.
Okay. Don't be a distraction. All right, awesome. Who else?
Obey God.
Obey God, okay, okay. Anybody else have any ideas of what it looks like to worship?
Just kind of put your hands in the air and just kind of close your eyes and like sing a song.
Close your eyes and sing a song.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
What?
Do what your parents say and do the chores that you're asked to do.
Okay, right on. Very good. Do chores. All right, awesome. So remember today, you guys, okay, you're our leaders. You guys are going to lead us because Jesus said to be more like you guys. So when you guys are dancing up here in the front and you guys are singing and you guys are worshiping, we're actually learning from you guys. And we want to be more like children because he says that that is the greatest in the kingdom, is to be like a child. Okay, so remember that today. When you guys are worshiping and you guys are just encountering God with his presence, don't forget, you in a way are leading us too. Okay? So just bow your heads with me. I want to bless you guys. So God, thank you so much. Just one second. Any of the parents or youth teachers want to come and lay their hands on the kids? And we're going to bless them right now, okay? We're going to bless them. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for these kids, Lord. They are a treasure to our hearts. We love them so much. Each and every one of them has such an amazing calling, amazing gifting on their lives. They have an amazing heart for you, Jesus, and we're so thankful for them, Lord. As leaders, as parents, Lord, help us to guide them and direct them, Lord, closer and closer to you, God. I bless them today. I thank you, Jesus, that you tell us to be more like a child, Lord, and that today we're going to learn from them. We're gonna be like a child in your presence, every one of us, Lord God. And so we just release your presence over these children, Lord. I thank you for them. I thank you for the spirit of joy that's going to come out of them today. I thank you for the spirit of excitement that's going to come out of them today, the spirit of worship that's going to come out of them today, the songs that you're going to give them, Lord God, the amazing peace that's going to fill them today in worship, Lord God. We are believing you, Lord, as parents and as adults and as youth leaders today, Lord God, that you would encounter our kids in worship, that you would encounter our kids today in their classrooms, that you would encounter them with your heart, Lord, and that they would know that you love them and that you're with them and your presence is all around them, Lord. So I thank you for these kids, and we bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Bless you guys. All right. Bless you guys. Ava, come here. I want to bless you. And I bless you too in Jesus' name. All right. Well, bless you guys. We did forget it last week, so I'm like, we got to take care of it right away. We got to bless these kids. It is so important, you guys, to be consistent in our prayers, to be to be fervent, earnest in our prayers. And I believe the Lord that every single time we pray, every single time we open our mouth for our kids, He does it. He fulfills it. He answers prayer. And the more that we go after our kids and pursue our kids, the less the enemy in the world is going to have a hold on them. So we're going to fight for our kids. We're going to stand up for our kids, and we're not going to back down, because love never fails and love never gives up. So we're not giving up on our kids. So we got a bullseye on each one of you guys. We got a bullseye. You are marked for heaven. There's a target on each and every one of you guys for heaven. So I bless you guys. All right. Yes, amen. So this week, the Holy Spirit just impressed upon my heart, just the heart of the Father. And He led me through some amazing scriptures and amazing passages, and I wanted to share them with you guys. It's always good to be reminded of the Father's heart. There's so many different controversies out there and so many different opinions about what the Father is like. He's judgmental. He's angry. He's upset. He's pouring out His wrath. Oh, this happened because, you know, God is dealing with sin, or this. There's so many different things. And for the most part, some of them are negative, because when Zach and I go out and we witness to people and we tell them about Jesus, and they're like, oh, we don't want nothing to do with that, you know, and then they tell us their opinions about what God's like. And it's most of the time it's wrong. So it's always good to be reminded of the Father's heart. What's on His heart? What is He thinking about? Is He in a good mood, or is He angry with everybody? Is He upset? What's going on, you know? And so for me this week, it was just so beautiful, because once again, the Holy Spirit, He just reminds me what the Father is like. And so He told me, I want you to go through Hosea. I want you to go through the story of the prodigal son, and I want you to go through the story of the woman caught in adultery. And little did I know that when He was showing me these stories, that there was the amazing character and nature of the Father revealed in each one in a unique way. And so I just want to share those things with you guys, and just reminded where the Father is at, where His heart is, and what He thinks about all of us, and what His true heart towards us is. Oh, thank you, Lord. So I started with the book of Hosea, and I love the story of Hosea. If you guys haven't had a chance to read Hosea yet, it's an amazing story of redemption. How fearlessly the Father pursues His children. How fearlessly, to the extent that the Father is willing to go after His kids. Even in their mess, even in their sin, even in their adultery, even in their idolatry, the extent. So He sent this amazing prophet named Hosea. And He said, Hosea, I'm calling you to do something really challenging, but it's because it's for My children. So Hosea had the really, really difficult task of going and marrying a woman who was a prostitute. And God said, this is what I want you to do, Hosea. I want you to go and I want you to marry her. And I want you to love her, even though she's a prostitute, even though she's an adultery, even though she has many husbands. I want you to love her. I want you to purchase her. I want you to go get her. And this is what it says in Hosea. This is the Father's heart. Therefore, I am now going to allure her. I will lead her into the desert and speak tenderly to her. I long to redeem them. In that day, declares the Lord, you will call me my husband. You will no longer call me my master. I will be betrothed to you forever. The Lord said to me, Hosea, so this is now Hosea receiving the word of the Lord directly to him. Go, show your love to your wife again, though she is loved by another and is an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loves the Israelites. So Hosea went and he bought her, even though she was in this adultery, even though she was a prostitute, he went and he bought her. The Lord says, I long to redeem them. And then the Lord brought me through the other stories. The woman caught in adultery in the book of John. And it's so amazing. By anybody else's standards, by anybody else in the world, we know that this woman was, you know, in sin and there was shame. And then there was just a stain on her life because obviously she was also, you know, in many relationships. And so that's not good, right? So we immediately judge. But see, Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus says in the Gospels, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So we know that when Jesus is acting in this situation, it's the Father's heart to redeem. It's the Father's heart that doesn't judge and doesn't look down on people, doesn't condemn people, but he embraces them with love, for it's his kindness that leads them to repentance. And so this is what happens. They bring her out, all of the accusers, all of the people, the Pharisees, they bring her out into the streets, they throw her down in the dirt, and they all are ready to pick up their stones and throw their stone at her and judge her. But Jesus tells them, he who has never sinned, go ahead, cast the first stone. And one by one, all you hear, you don't even hear anybody saying anything. You just hear the stones just drop into the ground, drop into the down, because they know that they've all sinned. We've all sinned. We all fall short of the glory of God. Jesus looks up and he says, dear woman, where are all your accusers? Is there no one here to condemn you? And looking around, she replied, I see no one, Lord. And then Jesus says, then I certainly do not condemn you either. Certainly not. That's the heart of the Father, the heart of restoration, the heart of reconciliation, the heart to redeem somebody, even in the midst of their sin, even in the midst of caught in adultery, even in the midst of what they're doing. The Father's heart is to redeem, to restore. He doesn't say, get away from you, you're sinful. He says, no, come. I will redeem you, certainly. I don't condemn you. Go and from now on, be free from a life of sin. Be free. That's what Jesus wants. He wants freedom for all of us. And that's the Father's heart. So then I went to the story of the prodigal son. And I honestly, for me, and reading this story over and over again, I think this story is more about the father and less about the son. It's more about the good father. So I really believe this story should be called The Good Father, because that is an accurate portrayal of what the father does when we choose to turn our back on him, when we choose to run from him, when we choose to go away from him. This is the good father and what his response is and what he's really like. And so I want to share that with you guys, because I just couldn't get over this, how he responds. So the son comes into awareness. He took his inheritance from the father, and the father freely let him go. He wasn't holding him back or putting any condemnation or manipulation on him. Well, if you go, you're just going to spoil everything. He wasn't doing any of that. He just said, okay, here you go. If you want to go, you're free. So he left. And of course, he comes to the awareness after he squandered all his money, after he was in this situation of feeding pigs and getting to the point where he had to eat the pig food. He said, I want to go back to my father's house. I'm going to go and I'm going to tell my father, at least I can be a servant in your house. So he was already thinking below the way that the father thought about him. He was already thinking, well, I'll just be a servant, even though he's really a son. He said, I want to go back to my father's house, for I've sinned against him. I'm not even worthy to be called his son. But this is what happens. So the young son set off for home. From a long distance away, his father saw him coming, dressed as a beggar, and great compassion swelled up in the heart for his son, who was returning home. So the father raced out to meet him. He swept him up in his arms and he hugged him dearly and he kissed him over and over with tender love. That's the heart of the father. He's not pointing the finger. He's not telling you you're wrong. He's not telling you this is what you did. He is filled with tender love and compassion. They're home. They're home. They're in my arms again. That's who the Father is. That's his heart. And that's what he does every single time we choose to come back to him. He's not angry. He's not upset. He's waiting. He's just waiting with open arms every single time, waiting to just sweep you off your feet and cast out every one of your fears with his perfect love. That's who he is. That's the Father. So my prayer for you today, you guys, is that you would encounter the Father's heart, that you would know the reality of the Father's heart towards you, towards your situation, towards your kids. It's a heart of tender love and affection towards you and everything that's going on in your life. He cares deeply. He cares deeply. In my own personal story, you guys, of redemption, I was dating Zach for just not very long, but I really hadn't gotten to the point of depth with him where I had told him about my past. I hadn't told him that I had a divorce. I hadn't told him all these things. And it was starting to get like we were liking each other, right? He had a co-ed Bible study in his house, and I had been going to that, and it was amazing. But I can tell that there started to develop some feelings of attraction. And so I said, no, I can't. There's no way I can be with this guy. He has no idea what I've done. He has no idea what my past is like, all the baggage that I carry. No way. And so we made a plan to go to the Cheesecake Factory, and I was gonna break up with him. And so, but before I did, I wanted to be honest with him, and I wanted to come and tell him, this is why I can't be with you anymore. So I told him my past. I told him everything. And it was really challenging, but I knew that I had to do this because I wouldn't have been able to live with myself if I just broke up with him and didn't tell him the truth. So I just went through the whole list of everything, and we're sitting at the Cheesecake Factory, and Zach just starts crying. And I'm just like, oh no. What did I do? You know? And he just starts, I'm like, is something wrong? What's going on? Are you okay? And he's just like, he said he went into this vision and he saw me in the dirt kneeling before the cross, and he saw me worshiping at the foot of the cross where I saw guilt, shame, condemnation, a horrible past where I saw all these things. I'm like, no, I can't be with you. I'm not good enough for you. He saw something else. And I believe he captured the heart of the Father. I didn't see that. I couldn't see it, but he saw something greater. And he told me in that moment, you're going to be my wife. And I was like, what? Did you just not hear what I said? And oh man. That like just wrecked me. It wrecked me. But I believe it showed me also too how the Father always looks at us with eyes of redemption. He sees us redeemed. He sees us healed. He sees us whole. He sees our victory. He sees us in the future. He already sees the work is accomplished. That's how he sees us, with eyes of gold towards each and every one of us. So that's my prayer today, you guys, is that you would capture the Father's heart. You would know that you were accepted in the Beloved and that he's proud of you. So as you worship today from a place of freedom, knowing that the Father is proud of you and he loves you. So go ahead and stand with me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, thank you so much for revealing your heart to us through these stories. Thank you so much for your heart towards each and every person, Lord. Thank you, Father, that is your heart to redeem and restore and love every single person, Lord, with extravagant love. I pray that they would feel your embrace today, Lord. I pray that you would surround them with arms of loving kindness, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that as you hold them dear to your heart, Lord, that all their fears, all their anxieties, all their pressures and stresses of the week would just melt away. Father, you're so loving. You're so kind. Lord, I pray that every person would be reminded of that, Lord, in every circumstance of life that they're going through right now, Lord, that they would be reminded of your love, Lord. Thank you, Father. I'm even reminded now, Father, that while we were sinners, that word just kept on standing out to me. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. In the midst of our sin, Christ died for us. Knowing that we would never earn anything, we would never be good enough, we would never be able to pay the price. But while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son, making a way where we could never make a way. You're so good, Father. You're so good. So it is with thankfulness and gratefulness and gratitude in our hearts, Lord, that we worship you today, Lord. We praise you, Father. We love you so much. Thank you for first loving us. We bless you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
How I love to hear your voice that speaks my name. You give me faith to stand and see with hope again. And when I hear your words of life, a hunger stirs like fire inside. Speak to me, call me from the darkness. Just one word can break my heart, with what breaks yours, Jesus. Jesus, I hear you singing over me. You call my name. How sweet the sound, the voice of God. It's when I hear my Savior's voice, I know it's true. That you can take a broken life and make it. I'll always stay and hang on every word you say. Speak to me, call me from the darkness. Just one word can break my heart, with what breaks yours. Call my name, how sweet the sound, the voice of God. Speak to me. Oh, speak to me. Call me from the darkness. Just one word can break my heart, with what breaks yours. The voice of God, when God speaks, when God speaks, nations will tremble. When God speaks, everything changes. When God speaks, we will surrender. Oh, God, speak, whisper your love song. Fire, oh God, speak, and I will surrender. voice of God. Speak, Lord. Call my name, sweet the sound, the voice of God. Jesus, I hear you singing. Jesus, I hear you singing over me. You call my name, how sweet the sound, the voice of God.
Light me on fire, oh God. Light me on fire.
your fire burn. Come down from heaven, let your fire burn. Set us on fire, let your fire burn. Oh, come down from heaven. Open us up, Holy Spirit, help us, Lord. Let your fire burn. Come down from heaven, let your fire burn. Consume us from heaven, let your fire burn. Oh, we now surrender. We surrender, Lord. There's so much more. We surrender, Lord. We surrender, Lord. There's so much more. Oh, let your fire. Like they did in the upper room, help us to wait on you. Holy Spirit, help us to wait on you. The rush of fire above our heads, rush of fire above our heads, the rush of wind. Oh, come like you promised. With a rush of wind, fire above our heads, the rush of wind, fire above our heads, the rush of wind. Come like you promised. Come like you
after his presence.
You're all that we want. You're the only one that's satisfied. Oh, you're the breath that I breathe. You're the air in my lungs. You're the vision that I see. It's you. It's you. It's you. I just love to see your face.
of every moment, every song is worthy. Your perfume. Don't save any. It's not meant for anybody else. Pour out all your perfume on the feet of Jesus. Pour it all out. Everything. Let the one thing grip your soul. Worship. Worship.
Jesus, we
Says, let my love continually nourish your hearts. If you're dry, let his love nourish your heart. If you're anxious, let his love nourish your heart. Let the Holy Spirit teach you how to be still in the sweet presence of the Lord. For that is all you need for life and godliness. It's all you need. Right now, as you take communion with your families, if you need to get right with Jesus, ask him to forgive you for any wrong you've committed towards him, any way you've grieved the Lord. Say, Lord, forgive me for not walking in fellowship with your love and in awareness that your love is stronger and more overpowering than any temptation, any sin, any shame. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Just like Laura said earlier, let his love nourish your heart. Let the blood of Jesus wash you again today. Let him clean you inside and out and create in you a new heart, a heart that is united to fear his name. And as you take the bread, the body of the Lord, and remind yourself that the Lord was broken on your behalf so that you could walk in wholeness, give thanks for that. Go ahead and receive in Jesus' name. That got us here today. None of us are where we're at aside from his mercy and grace. Now I want you to just take a second, a moment, and pray for an unsaved friend or family member that the Holy Spirit brings to your mind right now. Pray for their salvation. Declare it. Believe God for it. Ask God to capture that person's heart to be saved. Intercede for that soul to come to know you like you know the Lord. Say, Lord, bring them to this table to feast on your body and your blood like I am right now. I can't enjoy this all by myself. I have to bring others. Let the unsaved in my life call upon the name of Jesus. And wherever I go, let the harvest come in supernaturally by my life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Guys, let's stand and give thanks to the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Thank him for his sweet presence. Give one another a hug. Bless one another. Thank God that we're not on this journey alone, and we have each other to walk with.
Come running. There's something in the sound of your voice that speaks to every part of me. When I hear the sound of your voice, I'm alive. made to love you. It's all I really know for sure. All I am is wrapped up in you, the center of my world. And I was made to love you. From my beginning to my end, and you'll be my forever. My forever, amen. Let me hear the sound of your voice, and I will leave it all behind. Let me hear the sound of your voice, and I'll come running. There's something in the sound of your voice that speaks to every part of me. And when I hear the sound of your voice, I'm alive. Oh, I was made to love you. It's all I really know for sure. All I am is wrapped up in you, the center of my world. And I was made to love you. From my beginning to my end, and you'll be my forever, my forever, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
What's up, man? Good to see you. Hey, good to see you, man. Hey, did you get my text messages?
Oh, will you ask your mom if she'll let you use your phone?
Respond to me.
Say the pastor that she's down there.
I want to give thanks to the Lord for the tithes and offerings that you guys faithfully sow into this family. Everything you sow will be multiplied back to you.
Oh, yeah.
It will. It's a guarantee of the Lord. The Lord said it from his own mouth. I dare you to test me in this area. Yeah. Every penny you sow. And sometimes we go into that tithe box and we pull out checks, we pull out cash, and in the bottom we pull out pennies and dimes and nickels. And I thank God for the penny. I thank God for the check. I thank God for the cash. And I just say, Lord, this is yours. This money's yours. We're stewarding this for you. It does not belong to us. How do you want to invest this? How do you want to multiply it? And we pray over every person that gives. Yeah. That you'd be blessed abundantly. The Psalms say, Lord, bless me abundantly so that I can walk in your ways. Amen. If I lack anything, I can't fully and holistically walk in your ways. I have to be blessed. Yeah. I have to be blessed. Yes. Don't get me wrong here. But you got to learn how to be content, whether you have a lot or a little. But when the Lord desires to bless you, he wants to bless you in every way. He wants to bless you in every way so that you can handle things even more loosely and give more away. And you can say, man, that my child right there is emptying themselves out too quickly. We got to bless them more. We got to give them more. We got to pour out the righteousness of heaven upon them. So I want to thank the Lord right now For every penny that has been sowed into Zion over the last 2 years and that is continually sowed into this place, God, I thank you for your provision in order that the kingdom of God can go forth and the gospel can be preached so that people can be saved, healed, delivered, and discipled into wholeness so they can walk with you, because this salvation is too great for us to keep to ourselves. So we offer to you our very clothes, our time, our businesses, our money, our mouths, the words we speak, our actions. We give ourselves to you as an offering. And I thank you, Lord, for every seed that's been sown by your faithful people. I pray you bless them abundantly, make their heads spin, meet every need they have in their lives. And if anybody in this place is experiencing lack, I speak the supernatural grace of the Lord to anoint you and give you everything you need to move forward in the calling and the promises that he has for your life. In Jesus' name. All right. Well, we're moving a little slow today. You guys okay with that? Okay. How many of you guys need more of the rest that comes from the yoke of the Lord? He places a yoke on you, and that yoke, just like you would place a yoke on an ox when the ox is plowing the field, the Lord wants to do that to every one of his kids. And yet his yoke is not burdensome, it's light. That's one of the mysteries of the gospel, is that the Lord can burden you with heaven, with himself, with his heart, and somehow you feel relieved. Somehow you feel at rest. And that's available to every one of us. Every one of us today. Rest, his yoke. We're going to continue speaking about hunger today. We're going to eat right now. We're going to get into the word. We're going to feed ourselves. And we're going to ask the Holy Spirit to help us digest the Word of God so that we're not just hearers of the Word, but doers of the Word. Yes. I love the Word of God. I love hearing the Word of God, but I don't want to stop there. I want to be a doer of the Word of God. I want my life to be saturated with the Word of God so it plays out in my practical life, that I have wisdom for complicated situations, that I have power and strength for uncomfortable situations. It all comes from the Word of God. And the Holy Spirit is anointing us in this day. I believe there's a fresh outpouring of wisdom available to the bride of Christ. Right now in this season that we're in, 2021, I believe the Lord is giving the anointing of wisdom and revelation if you ask for it. And it's coming easier than ever because he wants his bride to walk in the fullness of understanding. Who is Jesus? Who am I? What is the kingdom of God? What does it look like for me today in 2021 in the life that I live? God wants to overwhelm you with wisdom. And today as we eat, I ask, Holy Spirit, that you do what only you can do. Transition as we move from worship to feasting on the Word of God. Let your triumphant voice speak clearly to us and transform our hearts and renew our minds in the presence of God. In Jesus' name. Just declare this over yourself. Lord, bless me. Increase my tolerance for godliness. Increase my capacity for holiness. Anoint me to be blameless. Strengthen me, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Many of you guys are experiencing this wisdom. You're finding yourself just hearing things of the Lord, seeing things. You have understanding for things. How many of you guys have been experiencing wisdom this year in your time with God, your private time with God? Like you get into the Word and things are just standing out to you clearly. When you've read that passage 1,000 times before and all of a sudden you see something that you didn't need to go to seminary to understand, he just gives it to you because he knows you need it for the season you're in and he loves you. Yeah. It's so good. It's so good. My messages keep multiplying, and I ask the Lord, hold on for just a second so I can type, because the stuff you're showing me is so good. It's feeding me, and I trust that if it feeds me, it's going to feed you guys. And all I can do is minister to you out of the love in which the Lord ministers to me. I'll have nothing more. I have nothing less than that ever. It's never going to be in my own strength. I have to hear from God on a weekly basis. And not only hear from God, I have to experience Him in order to give you anything. Yeah. For it to be authentic and genuine. Because in your experience with Jesus, whatever sections of the Word of God have authority over you, you now have the authority to release that Word and teach that Word in other people's lives and see it imparted into that person's life. I can't wait to share with you guys some of the books Laura and I are getting into right now. We're going to talk about supplements. I shouldn't say that. You don't need a supplement to the Word of God. How about that? Hear me say that. If all you have is the Word of God, you have enough. But sometimes the Holy Spirit will lead you to learn from other people's lives who figured it out, who figured out how to walk with Christ and learn from the Word of God. And then you learn from their lives. Their testimony becomes a prophecy into your life too, for God to do it again. And so help me, Holy Spirit. Help me stay focused here. I want to just, sometimes it's not a racetrack with a given direction. It's just an open field. And it's like, well, let's just run around. Where are we going? Let's just have fun in this thing. And that's where we're at in the Word of God today. We're gonna continue talking about hunger, but I want to try to get more practical. What does hunger look like, all right? It's been fun. All right, Genesis 32. And I'm probably going to go a little fast today. Genesis 32. I don't know. Yeah. Genesis 32. I love this story. 32, 22 through 32. All right. How many of you guys know what it feels like to wrestle with God? To get into it and to do business with God? Genesis 32, 22 through 32. Let's stand and read this together. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants. Let me just stop. Are we in the right place? Is the scripture correct? Are we good? All right. All right. His two female servants and his 11 sons, and crossed the fjord of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone. Jacob sent everything he had into the future, and he was left alone in his present moment. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. And when the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Verse 28, then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Amen. Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." Wow. The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. Wow. In Jesus' name, you can be seated. So practical hunger, what does it look like? Hunger helps you find your destiny. Hunger helps you find your destiny. Hunger helps you find God. And being unsettled in life is a gift. It's a gift if you allow it to create hunger that stirs you to seek God instead of despair. For in your unsettled restlessness, God is trying to wake you up. He's trying to wake you up, and before you can go to the other side, before you can get into your calling, before you can get into your destiny and your future, God wants to get into it with you. It's not called a fight. It's called a wrestling match. I'm going to show you. This Hebrew word that's used here is only used here in the entire Bible. And it doesn't mean to fight and resist God. It means to wrestle. It means to get into it, to grapple with God. It's a very specific meaning. God did this to John G. Lake. John G. Lake is one of my favorite people to read from. And in his book, Adventures with God, John G. Lake describes this holy unsettledness and restlessness that overtook his life to where he couldn't focus on his normal daily tasks anymore. He was an insurance salesman making thousands of dollars, and in his office, he couldn't even sit in a deal anymore and try to close the deal without first making sure that person heard the gospel. And so he would stop talking about insurance, and he'd say, "Can I tell you about Jesus? Can I share the good news with you?" And pretty soon, he got so unsettled where he was at that his boss told him to take 2 months off. And in that 2 months off, he prayed, and he gave everything he owned and everything he had, he gave it away as the Lord directed him. And he said to his wife and his kids, "We are all in, fully, totally consecrated to the Lord. We're going to rely on Him from this day forth." I don't know if it looks exactly like that for us. Each of us has to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. But John G. Lake talks about how he woke up and how he got the gift of hunger. He went on a mission trip to Africa, left the United States, and as he was camping one evening, a mother brought in her baby that had fallen while she was carrying the baby in the dark, and the baby broke its neck. And John G. Lake was overwhelmed by his lack of faith. He didn't know how to pray for that extent of healing. And the Lord revealed to him exactly where the level of his faith was at in light of this baby that just had its neck broken. John G. Lake was traveling and ministering with another family, an African-American family. And in that family was an African-American man who went over to that baby and began praying for healing over that baby's neck. And in a moment, that baby's neck was healed. And that was one of the first miracles that John G. Lake saw in Africa on a mission trip. He came back to the United States and he was gripped with a hunger to see that here in America. Amen. He said, "God, I saw something over there in Africa that gave me a desperation and a hunger. I have to devote my life to see the healing power and virtue of the Holy Spirit here in the United States." So he started these tent revivals. And as he went through these tent revivals, healings weren't breaking out, but he was staying faithful. He was preaching the gospel. He believed, and he said, "Lord, help my unbelief, increase my faith." And soon enough, in months and months of hunger, the Lord increased his faith and the power of God on his life, and he began to see miracles and even resurrections in his meetings. Blind people healed, people coming out of wheelchairs. And John G. Lake allowed that hunger. Instead of disturbing him and making him feel bad for where his faith was at, he came back and said, "No, I want that. I want what that man has." You know, I knew for years what I was supposed to do. The moment I got saved, it's like the Lord gave me a vision of my life. He says, "Your life now is to be surrendered to the gospel at all costs. You're to do nothing else with it." I was getting ready to go to art school, wanted to do photography, graphic design, do music, just whatever in the art field. The Lord completely removed that desire and gave me a desire to go to Bible college. I was so hungry to just get into the Word that I just chose the closest school, which was Boise Bible College. And I come to find out, I don't even agree with everything they teach. But it didn't matter. I just wanted the Word. And I said, "I don't care who's teaching it. I want the Word." And I got hungry. And then, later on in life, as I graduated from seminary, the Lord showed me some things. And I started a construction company. But I got comfortable in that field. Laura and I were doing well. We were making a good living. We were happy. Things were growing. Our business was prospering. And I got comfortable. And after years of that, the Lord reignited this holy, holy unrest. This hunger. And oftentimes it would come from my wife. I'd come home and say, "Hey, we just got this job. This is going to bring this amount of provision, and we're going to learn this, and we get to hire these subcontractors." And it was great. It was great. It was like supposed to be good news. And then Laura would say, "How's your heart? Is it what you want? Are you doing what the Lord told you to do?" And the Lord would use my wife, and it would make me angry. We'd usually end in an argument. I'd say, "Can you just be thankful? Like, we have work, we're blessed, the Lord, there's no secular and sacred, the Lord's in our business," and you know, all that stuff. But you know when the Lord is stirring you up for something, and my wife would continually remind me, "When are you going to step out and start doing what the Lord has really told you to do?" And I knew for years, it's not about being a pastor, it's just I didn't want to do anything else with my time other than display the Word of God and see people changed by the Word of God. That's all I want to do. And it got to the point where it didn't matter how blessed we were at work. I'd be on the job and I just would want to be preaching the gospel. I'd want to be talking to people about something else other than flooring, paint, trim, money, budget, invoicing. I wanted to talk to them about Jesus. And I made the decision, "All right, Lord, however long construction lasts, I'm recalibrating how I do business. My first priority is to preach the gospel. Business is second." And if I lose a job because I preach the gospel, then so be it. I don't care. You'll give me another one. And so I started praying with people, telling them about Jesus. And actually, it opened more doors. People got to know that, oh, you're here not just to work for me, but you're here to actually show me another world and you care about my soul. And you know, of course there's awkward encounters and all that stuff, but there was a holy unrestlessness. How many of you guys know what I'm talking about? When the Lord is trying to wake you up to a hunger to do what you're supposed to be doing. And it'll eventually bring you to a crossroads, a breaking point. Where I had a moment in my life where I had to choose one or the other. Even though I'm still doing construction right now, it's different in my heart, trust me. It's something only the Lord can do because my first priority is to preach the gospel, no matter what. And ever since I gave myself all in fully 2.5 years ago, I've been at rest in the grace and work of the Lord. And you guys know what I'm talking about. When, you know, some of you have a vision that Christ gives you to just be an amazing mother. And you know that's what you're supposed to do for a season. Or God will give you a vision to actually go into business and start a certain type of business and run it this way, the way that the world has never seen. You just have to differentiate, you have to discern the voice of the Lord for yourself and your calling and what He's telling you to do. But see, if you're confused in life, if you're depressed, if you're restless or angry, maybe it's because there's a fight you're not engaging in. Maybe you're fighting too much of the enemy and you're exhausted and you need to get over on the other side. You need to start wrestling God a little bit for your destiny. It's the fight to know God and walk in His power and love so that you can have dominion on the earth. That's the whole commission. He started that in chapter 1 of Genesis. I created man and woman to have dominion on the earth. That's the primary calling. We were supposed to steward this life and this planet on behalf of the Lord with dominion and power. So that you can be victorious and not a victim. Destiny can only be experienced if there's something worth fighting for. So here's some observations I had about this story. Number one, get in the dust. Get in the dust. The Hebrew word used here to describe Jacob and God is abak. It's actually pronounced avak. The V in Hebrew looks like a B. Avak, and it's only used here. Now, when a word is only used in one particular story, it's very significant. The word is avak. It's used twice in Scripture, only in this story, and it literally means to get in the dust. Get in the dust. Think about this. In our pride, when we're standing tall in our own strength, we're limited in what we can see. We're trying to stay clean. We're trying to have our lives all put together. We're afraid to get low. But it's only when we humble ourselves and get on our knees and get in the dust with God and wrestle for the future of our souls that our destiny finally begins to get worked out. Humble yourself before the Lord. Humble yourself before the Lord. Get on the ground, get yourself dirty, and wrestle with the Father of your future for your destiny. Stop standing tall in your pride and trying to think your life is all together and you're clean. It's not where God wants you. In order to cross that river, in order to cross into your future, you have to get in the dust with God. You cannot experience your destiny apart from humbling yourself before God. You know what I did? I humbled myself. I said, God, I don't have the strength to get out of what I'm doing. I'm comfortable. Help me. Help me. Help me make the transition. I asked for help. I got in the dust. I said, I don't care what it looks like. I just need help. Work out your salvation. Your destiny is too great to accomplish in your own strength. It must be entered into by the Spirit. So number two, don't quit. Hungry people don't quit until they get their meal. Hungry people don't quit until they get their meal. Was Jacob hungry for food? No. He had everything. He had all his possessions, his family, his wife. He sent it all over the other side of the river. He lacked nothing, but he was hungry for blessing. He was hungry for destiny. He was hungry for identity. You can have everything in the natural and still be yearning for meaning and truth and identity. Verse 24, they wrestled until daybreak. So this wasn't a quick wrestling match. When's the last time you saw a boxing match or something that lasted until daybreak? It lasted all evening. No way. See, the wrestling match for your destiny is greater than any fight you'll ever watch on TV or experience with man. They wrestled until daybreak. And then verse 26, Jacob dares to say, I will not let you go until you bless me. And his hip had already been dislocated, so he's already injured. He's already in a state of weakness. But guess what? It wasn't until he was in a place of weakness that he cried out with a demand and a boldness towards heaven. So often, God has to dislocate something in your life and humble you in order to get the cry to rise out of you for blessing. I will not let you go until you bless me. Jude 3:3 says, contend for your faith. It's not the same word used here as wrestle, but it's similar to the meaning. It means contend for your faith. Fight for your faith. James 5:16, the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man avails much. I love these promises. I promise you that when you learn to contend in prayer, you will get what you're asking for. Everything I'm praying for right now, if I'm fervent with it, I will see it answered. That's right. That's right. Everything you're praying for, you will see it. Right. When you fight for your destiny, when you learn to pray consistently over what you want to experience in the future with God, you will see it. You will see it. Don't pray from sight. Your wrestling, your fighting has to come from within. It can't come from the outside. You pray effectually and fervently, and you will avail much. It's fascinating that in the footnotes, if you study the story of Genesis 32, in the footnotes, the first reference I came across was Luke 18:1. It says, and he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always pray and not lose heart. It's the parable of the persistent widow. You have to wrestle in prayer for your future. You have to persist. As annoying as my Chihuahua can be at times, God preaches to me through that little annoying dog. I've wanted to get rid of that dog. My family won't let me. And now I'm using that dog in my sermon. That Chihuahua knows more about persistence than a lot of Christians do in their prayer closet. That Chihuahua will pounce up against the back door continually until you let him in. He will come and scratch on your leg and bother you until you pick him up. You know, what are we supposed to be learning here? Don't give in. Don't quit. Hungry people don't quit. You persevere in what you're praying for. You see, many of us have to have our souls gripped with such hunger that we pursue God at any cost and we don't stop until he blesses us. Just say this to yourself. I'm not going to stop until you bless me, God. This is biblical. You don't always have to say, Lord, break me. It's actually biblical to say, bless me. Because Jacob said, bless me. And guess what happened? He got blessed. He went over across the river. His relationship with his brother was restored. He got land. You know, so when you say, Lord, bless me, don't feel bad. Don't feel bad. But just remember, something in you has to get dislocated in order for you to properly say that prayer. You have to be broken and dead to yourself if God is supposed to bless you so that you steward those things through Christ and not through your own flesh. Amen. You know who else contended all night for their destiny and wrestled until daybreak? Jesus. Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith. Do you know in order for him to be the author and perfecter of your faith, he had to experience everything that you could possibly go through and have victory over it so that you could find victory in him by relying on him? Had Jesus not persevered until daybreak in the Garden of Gethsemane, you would have no salvation to be a part of. Had Jesus not wrestled all night, you would not be here today, neither would I. How many people are out there waiting for their breakthrough, but they cannot get it until you wrestle for your destiny? God showed me there's thousands of people that won't hear the gospel unless you fully surrender to preaching it, Zach. I have these people marked out for you to lead to Jesus. He's saying it to you. There's thousands, maybe millions of people that cannot be touched until you wrestle for your destiny and strive through the night until daybreak, until you get blessed. Your breakthrough opens the door for them because now in your yielding, God can use you. Your destiny belongs to you, but it will not be given to you unless you fight for it and attain it. Wrestling with God is when the intensity of your will and the intensity of God's will finally collide, and he dislocates your will in order for you to be overcome by his. And it's not just, like Catherine Kuhlman said, it's not some of me and some of you. It's not even less of me and more of you. It's none of me, all of you. I've prayed this prayer. I say, Lord, dislocate whatever you want to dislocate in my life so that my will is broken, so that I can walk completely in your will, so that others can benefit from my life. Hungry people don't give up. They fight. Number two, hungry people ask and ask and ask again. Hungry people are annoying. Jesus said it. If you bother him enough, you will get what you ask for. You ask and you ask and you ask again. Hungry people ask for the gift of hunger. Say, Lord, move me out of my complacency. Help me not to be lukewarm. Ask the Father in Jesus' name right now. Awaken my soul to hunger. Christianity was never meant to be a religious thing. Religion's dead. Religion accomplishes nothing. I don't care how much money and prestige religious organizations have. Whatever they build is death if it's not relationship with Jesus. It's where his love for you and your love for him create a bonfire of passion. So that you can say, like the word of God says, his fire is in my bones and I can't escape it. I have to speak like Jeremiah said. Ask Jesus to make his love awaken your own. You have such a greater capacity to love Jesus that you have yet to experience. And it's his love for you and an awareness of his love that awakens your love for him. Both the bridegroom and the bride have to pour out something in their display of affection for there to be a relationship. Jesus poured out his blood. And for us, we pour out our perfume, our worship. And maybe one day our blood, I don't know. Who knows? Jesus poured out his blood in his offer of worship to the Father. You pour out your perfume, that's your worship. How you live your life, you worship the Lord. And in the same way, the power of Jesus' blood transcends the natural. The power of your worship changes the spiritual climate of your life. If you want your life to be different, then learn to prioritize worship. Learn to fortify your secret place and seek God and worship him, and it will change the climate of your life. And then something beautiful begins to happen. An awareness of Jesus' love for you keeps you from sin. His love becomes more powerful than any temptation. His love guards you from selfish behavior. How many of you want to experience full, complete authority over every temptation and love of self in your life?
Yes, amen.
It's possible.
Oh, yes.
It's possible. Ask Jesus to help you get there. And you can say, I'm way too loved to be acting this way. Lord, forgive me. I love you. I'm way too loved to go to that. I'm way too loved to act this way. Number three. A practical way of hungering after God is that you answer God when he asks you something. One of the aspects of this story is that it's shrouded in a lot of mystery. It's very mysterious. One of the mysteries is that God asks Jacob who he is. Isn't it funny when God asks questions because he knows everything? I mean, he formed Jacob in his mother's womb. He knows who he is, but yet he shows up and instead of giving answers, he asks questions. Who are you? What are you doing here? Sometimes the Lord will ask me, Zach, what are you doing here at Zion? Why are you showing up? What are you looking for this Sunday? Oh, Lord, I'm coming after you. It's all about you. It's not about church. It's about you. You know, he asks us these questions. Why are you getting up to pray? Verse 27, the man asks, and it's interesting, Scripture calls him a man when this is actually God, and we'll get into more of that maybe later. But the man asks Jacob, what is your name? And Jacob answers. Jacob doesn't mess around. He answers. See, when God asks questions, it's always for your sake, not for his. The question is always for you. It's always for you. It's not for him. God's question is the answer. God's question is the life-changing encounter. And if God is asking you a question, it implies that he's present, and his presence alone is the atmosphere for revelation. Job wanted understanding, and God showed up, and he says, let me question you. Stand up like a man and hear me. And God just asked Job questions. And somehow at the end of all the questions God asked Job, Job said, now I see. Wow. Now I understand. But again, why the question? Why the question? Because by not yielding to your destiny, you can become someone the Lord doesn't know. Wow. It happens when there's a prolonged disconnect between us and God. And Jesus says in Matthew 7:23, and then I will have to declare to them on that day, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. This is something the Lord does not want to say. to anybody. And the Lord asks, what's your name? Who are you? Because he wants you to know who you are. He wants you to know the answer so that you don't have a prolonged disconnect with him. And on that day, he says, I never knew you. God in his mercy will pursue you with this question your entire life, asking who you are so you can answer it before it's too late. Because when you die, it's too late to find out who you are, and the Lord will have to say, I never knew you. You have to know who you are. You have to know why you're in relationship with the Lord. Who are you, the Lord asks. Do you know who you are today? Do you know why you were born? Do you guys have clarity and understanding about your identity in Jesus? Get with him in your secret place and allow him to ask you these questions. And the question and his presence alone will reveal to you who you are and what you were made for. When you realize that God has been pursuing you all your life, it will awaken a hunger in you to pursue him the rest of your life. It's like the song we were singing, you called me out of Egypt, you parted the water. I mean, he did that for every one of us who are walking with Christ. And the moment this recognition happens, the moment you respond with the answer of who you are, the Lord immediately gives you a new name. This is what he did in the story. As soon as Jacob answered with his name, he said, now I will give you a new name. Wow. He declares over you that you will no longer be the product of your past. So somehow in Scripture, without you knowing who you are, you cannot enter into the promised land. You have to first declare who you are presently, and then the Lord gives you a new name. He gives you your vision. He gives you your calling. And now your life is marked by your future instead of your past. That's what Jesus does to every person. Here's the transition. Jeremiah 29:11, he says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare, not for evil. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And he gives you a new nature. He elevates your natural understanding of yourself to a supernatural understanding of yourself. And you're no longer a product of your upbringing, but a product of the Father's declaration. You're a product of what he says about you.
That's right.
No matter how you slept, no matter what kind of dreams you have, you wake up and you declare over your life what the Father is saying to you, who you are. Do not go by your feelings. Go off of the declaration that God makes in Scripture and personally to you in your prayer closet. You're no longer a victim of lack, but a recipient of abundance because your Father's voice carries a new world. And the Father might say, I know you might not feel it right now in this moment, but this is who you are. This is who you are. And your feelings and your experiences will begin to line up with that declaration, and the experience of your life will change. He says, you're a child of God. You're a royal priesthood. You're co-heirs with Christ. I'm just seeing it on you guys. I don't need to say anything else. I'm seeing your identity in the Lord. You are not defined by your past. Get in the dust with God. Humble yourself on a daily basis. Wrestle Him. Your future depends on it. Other people depend on it. On you interacting with God and finding your hope and your future in Him. Isn't that amazing? The Word says, I came to give you a hope and a future. Everything in front of you, instead of being scared of it, instead of saying, oh my gosh, how many mountains am I going to come up against that are going to have to be moved? Listen, if you're taking territory in the Spirit, you're going to come up against mountains that need to be moved because you're taking territory. But see your future from His perspective, that there's nothing in your future that's not hopeful through Christ as you yield to Him. I'm going to ask right now as we stand up and pray, I'm just going to ask God to give us a boldness and a tenacity to pursue Him, to wrestle with Him for the future He has for us. Let's stand and pray. Before I close in prayer, I just, on an individual basis, just start asking the Lord. Asking the Lord to put inside of you what He put inside of Jacob. A desperation for Him. A passion for His name. Show us what it looks like to be humble. God, show us all what it looks like to wrestle with you so that our families can benefit, so that those around us who are unsaved can benefit from our lives. Unless a seed falls to the ground, it cannot bear fruit. Oh Lord, let there be amazing spiritual fruit that's produced through our lives, that other people will come and eat it. Use us and everything about us to make a difference in this land in which we're living. I just ask right now, fill us afresh with your Spirit. Along with the wisdom and understanding you're giving us, deposit within us a fire to know you, a passion to know you. And whether you feel it or not, declare this over yourself. I want Jesus more than anything. And I will get him. You are the Lord of my life, Jesus. You are my chief shepherd. You are the author and perfecter of my faith. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for caring enough to come encounter us in the night and to be willing to wrestle with us so that we can know who we are and be refined by your declaration and the name that you give us. We're defined by our calling in you. I bless each heart here today. God, let us be ignited with a passion to come after you, to keep pursuing you, to stay faithful, Lord, to not back off, to not get complacent, so that on that day when we see you, there will be tears and joy in your eyes saying, I knew you. I knew you. I knew you. We bless the Lord today in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to be up here available to pray. Kenneth, can you be available for any prayer that anybody has, any prayer needs? So good being with you guys. All right? The Lord is moving. The Lord's working. We are a people that captivate the Lord every Sunday.
Amen.
We are.
Amen.
We are. God is jealous for our love. Be blessed, you guys. Have another amazing week.